do you hear trombone shorty?
Training camp's a couple of weeks away. Where is the Colts training camp?
Grant Park?
In Grant Park in Chicago.
Isn't that downtown Chicago?
No, that voice. North of Carmel,
Indiana. Carmel, Indiana. Yep. I thought they just played basketball up there. That voice you hear in the background, that's George Odom. You play with the Colts. About to be a starter.
Need to be.
He's already an all pro. How many guys get to be all pro before they even get a starting gig? You know, that's what George does. He's penciled in as the free safety with the Colts, Central Arkansas grad here in San Antonio. Let's talk some football with George Odom.
Do you know where Central Arkansas is?
They got the purple field, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
Absolutely.
You guys played football during the pandemic. It was one of the first games I watched, wasn't it?
I think it was a very first game.
Hey, George, pull that microphone a little bit close to you. There you go. Don't be afraid of it, man. But my daughter went to Sam Houston State.
Oh, yeah, Sam Houston.
Yeah, so they used to play you guys.
You know, Jeremiah Briscoe?
Absolutely, the old quarterback.
God, he was tearing us up.
Yeah, back then, but they didn't win the title with Briscoe. They won the title in May.
Yeah.
You know, so, Briscoe was a hell of a quarterback. P.J. Watt was on that team. Now with, where is he? Is he still with the Texans?
P.J. Hall.
Or P.J. Yeah. Hall. He goes by P.J. Watt.
I believe they released him.
Yeah, I think they let him go.
Yeah, I think he was Houston now.
I think Houston let him go.
I think Houston let him go at the end of the season. I hope they kept him because I felt like he'd earned that job. George Odom joining us here on the Blitz, the pride of Millington Central High.
Went to Central
Arkansas. The believed, at least the Colts are telling me by a variety of depth charts, you're going to be the starting free safety, though. You're still going to have to go earn that. So as we sit right now, George, what are you doing? I mean, what do you do in preparation for training camp?
Well, right now, I had surgery back around 2 months ago. So I'm getting my leg back right now.
You look good now. What happened?
I had a scope done on my knee. So a little meniscus and a little cartilage, but I'm almost 100% right now. I should be back during training camp.
You're going to be back. I mean, if you follow George on Instagram, you realize he's in San Antonio today, but he had one hell of a weekend on a big old party boat in Minnesota.
Lake Minnetonka. It wasn't a party boat. It was a getaway. So basically my girlfriend,
I didn't know they put yachts like that on a lake.
Well, I guess when you have money, you can do whatever you want, huh?
Truer words never spoken. George Odom joining us here on ESPN San Antonio. So you were up on a lake in Minneapolis or Minnesota with your girlfriend. Big yacht.
Lake Minnetonka.
Lake, isn't that where Prince? Didn't you have purple rain? Wasn't
that
Lake
that.
Minnetonka?
I think somebody mentioned earlier.
Did you bathe yourself in the cold waters of Lake Minnetonka?
Yeah, I definitely jumped down and did some flips, some more stuff.
Yeah, if you remember, you know, back in the day, there was that party boat issue with some of the Vikings players.
I do recall that.
Not that George was on that boat.
Wasn't that boat called Monkey
Business?
I'm not that type of guy.
Well, no, you said you were there with your girlfriend.
Girlfriend and family.
So you're playing with the Colts. Of course, the Texans just around the corner from us. A lot of fear in the heart of the Colts as they prepare themselves for the Houston Texans this year?
No, not at all.
So are you penciling in a couple of bye games? Is that how you're handling this?
At the end of the day, there's no fear in our hearts. We put fear in other people's hearts.
Fair enough. Especially the Texans who are coming inadequately prepared to go ahead and take the.
They don't even know what they're going to do with their quarterbacks.
They don't. I mean, you know, they've got Taylor. They drafted a kid, Davis something or other from Stanford. How nice is it to look at the schedule and realize you're not going to have to see Deshaun Watson in the division?
Hey, that's a one-man army right there. So I'm glad. You never know, though. Never know.
So tell us about the Colts. This is a team that was in transition. You had Phillip Rivers last year who brought a bit of stability. Now you're moving on with Carson Wentz in this rebuilding process. Got a hell of a backfield.
It's great.
Good offense. What's it like looking at this offense? Do you see it expanding, getting back to where it was a couple years ago under Wentz, or is this going to be kind of a slower process growing this offense to catch up with your guys on defense?
In the last 4 years, I had different quarterbacks every year. So now we're still sustaining a good quarterback over the next 4 years. So now it's like we're reaching that point where we're not going against teams. Teams are going against us.
What's that point? Where do you start thinking that? Is it the manpower you've got? Is it winning a couple of games? Is it a new coach and a new belief? Where do you get from a team that's just out there to compete
It's just the players.
It's the players.
It's the players.
So going out expecting to win.
Just know every single rep, I'm coming with it.
Mm-hmm.
And so I know my teammates doing the same thing. And so it's accountability.
Makes sense. And where does that accountability start with? Is it from the coach? Is it from your vets? Is it from where does that begin inside of a football team?
Just the leaders in general. Just like with Frank, the coach, he installs a lot of hope and he shows that he guides us in the right direction.
Mm-hmm.
And so it always starts with direction, where we're going. And so we take it from there.
I think about the Indianapolis Colts post Peyton Manning. But playing in Indianapolis in a lot of ways kind of feels like what it was like for guys that played for the San Antonio Spurs, right? You know, you know, the town loves the team and the passion that goes with it, but it's very businesslike. And when Frank Reich went over there, became the head coach, I think about players like T.Y. Hilton that set the tone. But you mentioned you've got to have stability at quarterback. Carson Wentz was at one point an MVP candidate. If he could stay healthy, how good could that guy be? I mean, when he walked in the locker room, were you thinking, here's the guy from Philly? Or did you kind of,
I say this,
open mind
here's that,
going?
Here's that 2016 guy coming back to 2021.
That's a great teammate answer, but what's the truth?
You were like,
what's the truth?
I mean,
when you saw him throw,
he brings way more than what you think. So I mean, just for example, Phillip Rivers last year, we know what Phillip's going to do with his arm and stuff like that. You don't know what Carson Wentz is going to do with his legs and arm.
So going against him in practices,
it's way different compared to going against Phillip Rivers.
Really?
It's better dynamics. And coming up forward this year, we have an offense. Last year, we had an offense, but this year, we got an offense.
True.
You got a running back for sure. Jonathan Taylor, what's he like?
He's the man.
Is he?
Marlon Mack, the man.
Jordan Wilkins, the man.
Naheem Himes, the man.
That's a free safety talking. I believe they've met a couple times in the hole. We are joined by George Odum. He is a player with the Colts. He's an All-Pro. Last year, All-Pro, made it on the special teams. There's everybody I know that is great at special teams is half-ass crazy.
Crazy? I don't find it crazy.
Good. I'm glad you responded that way. Is there an art or is it a science to being a great special teams player?
I just say it like this. I'm not slowing down. I'm speeding up on the point of contact. I'm going to run through your face because you're not going to run through mine.
The want to.
I suddenly got a little afraid right there. I don't know about you. I can see that.
I mean, you moved back to me.
You kind of leaned in on that.
You know, but I mean, you look at that. You think about your NFL career. And here in San Antonio, we had a high school kid dominated at Smithson Valley, played at Rice. Drafted by the Cowboys, didn't make it, goes to the Jets, doesn't make it, plays in one of those spring leagues, and then gets a really nice contract from the Minnesota Vikings, Andrew Sendejo. Your story reminds me a lot of Andrew Sendejo. You know, just whatever it took to get there. And I think about, you know, you're a first-team All-Pro special teams guy, but what'd you get, like 25 snaps last year on defense? But they've got you penciled in as a starter. Less than that.
I have got less than that, but the very last game I played was Kansas City. And I should have got MVP that game. I got four. I got third down stops. I could have had two interceptions.
Did you get a cause of fumble?
Yeah.
Yeah. I remember that one.
Change the game.
I look at your total tackles for a special teams guy. You look like your stats read like a starter,
especially a Cowboy starter.
Well, you know, now wait a minute, dude. You bought a house in Dallas. We know your dreams to have a star on your helmet.
I don't know about a star for knocking people off.
I hope you guys are watching live at ESPNSA.com. That was a scowl.
Yeah,
Jason Minnix just got the look that a kick returner gets.
You know, probably the look that Dak Prescott gave you when you got your first career interception.
Oh, yeah, he blessed me with that one. But it wasn't his fault. It was a tight end. He didn't catch the ball. I'm going to capitalize on everything.
No, for the quarterback.
See, it wasn't Dak's fault. It's never the quarterback's fault.
It is always the quarterback's fault.
Hey, but if you're a good quarterback, you'll always hit your target. Remember that.
There you go.
And you'll throw your man open.
Take that from a safety. George Odum joining us here on ESPN San Antonio. I want to talk about that. The adjustment from Central Arkansas, you go undrafted, you get on a roster, you fight your way through training camp, and you're still there.
Yeah. I'm going to be here regardless of how long.
When you began this, what was the best advice you got?
So the dude, he's in my frat. I'm Phi Beta Sigma Fraternity Incorporated, named Corey Taylor. He came to me, he was like, hey, I got a training facility in Louisville, Kentucky. Come on down, da da da. So I get there. We're going through this. The first day, I'm on the treadmill. I'm like, oh, I'm running all I can. Like, dang, this is super hard. I got the last two runs. I said, I can't do it. I can't do it physically, mentally. I can't do it. I didn't do it. I came back the next day. He's like, all right, well, I'll start all over. I killed it that day. He was like, look at there, look here, George. There's a plan A and there's a plan B. But we're going to make this plan A work. And he said, I don't want to curse it, but he said, forget that plan B. Mm-hmm. We're going to make plan A work. And from there on out, hey, we're making a shake.
Did you think you were ready without him? Did you think you were physically ready to be an NFL player? Did you think you knew what work was? Did you think that before you walked on to the Colts practice field for that first day of post-draft rookie free agent OTAs, did you think that you were ready? And what was the difference for what you thought and what was?
Maybe my mentality, yes. Ah, man, yeah, I'm ready, da 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 da. Mm-hmm. But at the end of the day, I got out there. I'm like, oh, it's smoke and mirrors. Smoke and mirrors. You will never be ready for the NFL. You had to prepare your mindset to like, all right, I don't care what's happening, I'm gonna get it done. That's the mentality.
I love that statement. You cannot be ready until you do it.
Yep.
You cannot be ready. That's George Odum, safety with the Indianapolis Colts, sitting in with us here on ESPN San Antonio. Let's talk a little bit about you in general. So you got your next deal, which, you know, you're in good shape there. Moved to Dallas. What's your family life? Are you married? Got kids? What do you do?
Not married. Don't have no kids yet, but I want to have kids. Yes. I got a girlfriend right now. Mm-hmm. We're thinking about taking the next step right now. I have four dogs I train. I got German Shepherds. I breed them.
Shepherds, okay.
Yep. Amazing dogs. Love mm-hmm. my dogs. I'm a family-oriented man. I feel like this in life, I give more than I like to get.
Mm-hmm.
I'm the man with, if I say I'm going to do something, I'm going to get it done. Because at the end of the day, if your dad tell you something to do, what you going to do?
You're going
to
do it. Done.
But if your granddad tell you something to do, what's he going to do? He's going to do it with you. So I'm that type of person right there.
I like that.
I certainly appreciate that.
Now, you bought a house in Dallas.
Yep.
Why Dallas?
Why Dallas? Because at the end of my NFL career, I want to expand, and that's somewhere that's expanding kind of fast, and I want my money to grow.
Well said.
Smart man.
You know,
yeah, property taxes in Texas, income tax in Texas. How much does, when you think about, when you get that NFL money, and, you know, we hear, you know, various guys, you know, if you're playing in California, how people don't realize how 13, you guys get taxed.
13%.
You get California. Taxed on the state that you play a game in. And then if you're living somewhere, just the amount of taxes that.
They call it a Jordan tax. So basically, at the end of the day, if I have two residents, say if I have a residence in Indianapolis and I have a residence in Texas, I stay in Indianapolis most of the year. So I'm only getting taxed in Indianapolis. I'm not getting taxed for Dallas because even though I have a residence there, I'm going to have to pay property taxes on my house, but I'm going to have to pay taxes for Dallas.
Thank goodness.
What about your federal tax? I mean, you knew 13% off the top, right? Immediately. Cali, I play the Chargers or Rams or Niners. It's going to cost me 13%.
Oh, yeah, I know. I just got done. Actually, before I came here, I'm always talking about money. How can I make money? How am I spending my money to make more money at the end of the day?
All right. You're a guy that obviously has long-term plans, but let's look at the things that you did when you finally got a little money in your pocket. What's the first big purchase you made?
First big purchase.
One that you had to think
about. Signing bonus. I made $13,000, $8,000 out of the taxes. I bought my mama a car for $3,500. I got it fixed. She started driving that around. And
what'd you do for yourself?
I don't really do much for myself as I drive older cars, you know, 2015. I don't really buy uh-huh. newer cars. I don't really buy newer model things because at the end of the day, that depreciates in value.
All right. Kicks, jewelry. What? I mean, seriously.
I love Jordans. Okay. I have a closet full of Jordans.
There you go.
I have a. I probably spent $100,000 plus on clothes and shoes.
Okay. There you go. I would too.
I probably
spent
$25,000 in jewelry.
There you go. It's the jewelry. There's the jewelry. George Odum right here in ESPN San Antonio. So when do you go to camp?
When I go to camp, I got to report back on the 24th because I had surgery. Most players are coming back on the 27th.
Mm-hmm.
Camp start the first day of practice, I think the 29th.
Do you expect to be running on the first day or are you going to have to get cleared, you figure?
I'm running like a Kenyan.
When you're in San Antonio working out, getting ready, mind right, and just head off to camp from here?
Yeah. No. So I'm going to go back to Dallas for at least a few days. I'll have my girlfriend pack her stuff. It's the first time ever moving with a guy. She's very nervous, so I'm going to make sure the process is very easy for her. So it's going to go from there.
go from there. And last year is such a weird year for everybody, but for NFL players, for pro athletes, just dealing with all the COVID stuff. This year, all the debate on...
They're strong-arming you. So basically this year, like, either you're going to get the shot or
your
you might not
be
play.
Hell, right?
You might not play. At the end of the day, you got to come in an hour early. You got to take a test every single day. You can't sit in the building while you after you take the test. You got to sit outside for 45 minutes. And like, who want to do that?
Especially in Indianapolis. I want to get there early.
No, not at all. It's cold. It's going to be probably raining. You never know. So at the end of the day, I want to the least restrictions as possible. I want my family to come to the games. They want to come to the games too. So
I know that team business is team business and locker room halves need to stay behind that door. But what was the conversation like, or what has it been like as far as prepping for training camp and the vaccinations and what goes on in the locker room? Was there guidance given to you by the Colts? Was there discussions amongst your room and your groups about getting a vaccination? Or is it was really you guys just left up to your own and go make your own decision?
As a DB group, we've talked about who's getting it, who's not getting it. But at the end of the day, it's all about, it should be about what you want.
Right.
At the end of the day, it's the United States. It should be about what you want, not what the NFL wants. So say, for example, last year, we could wear masks all, you know what I'm saying? You don't have to get a COVID shot, we wear masks. This year, they said, you can't wear a mask in the building. Like, you can't wear a mask and not get the COVID shot. That is... outrageous. That is crazy. I don't know what word to put that in. No, but that is
BS.
Like,
I know what you're
like indentured slaving almost. Like, it's you gotta do this in order to be
They're
able to do this.
I'm telling you don't have to, but if you don't, we're gonna make your life miserable.
Right.
At the end of the day, yeah.
Well, I mean, that's ultimately what they've done.
It is.
But
so
from a team standpoint, you know, when every coach I've ever known put the team first, if you don't get the shot and you get sick, aren't you hurting the team if you've got to miss a certain amount of time, or if you end up you know
it should
I mean?
Be your choice, though, at the end of the day. If you want to get sick, that's on you.
Do you
last
get
year,
that?
I had COVID one time, and I've been around people that had COVID all throughout the year and stuff like that. I never got it again. But, yeah, they're making me take the shot.
Yeah.
Did you get much guidance from the Players Association, from your union reps?
Not at all. I've not heard from not one of them.
Interesting. It's a tough topic to deal with.
So far this year, I feel like our Player Association are weak-minded right now. I feel like at the end of the day, if we say no, it should be a no. Simple as that. There's no ifs, ands, or buts around it. That's my mentality. But other people's mentality is different than mine.
Would you ever consider getting involved with the union, being a rep yourself?
No. Because at the end of the day, you don't want to hear what I got to say.
Well, you're getting up in that veteran status. You know what I mean? You've been here. You get here 4, 5, 6 years. Suddenly, you're one of the older guys in the room.
Yeah. I mean, I'm old as it is right now. I'm 27.
Well, keep it to yourself. I got shoes older than you.
Hey, I got some shoes now. Hey, don't get me wrong. I still got shoes.
They don't look nearly as good as you do, too. That's George Odum, safety with the Colts, all pro. What do you get for being an all pro?
All pro GO.
Do you get you learn a secret handshake? Do they give you something special for being an all pro?
This past year, I learned like just perception. How do people see you? At the end of the day, nobody really teaches you that. So at the end of the day, like last year, like, all right, I focus on like, how am I going to beat this person in front of me? Like coaches tell you like, oh, you got to do this, you got to do that. But in all actuality, like I'm watching a film, like this dude get beats. Like if I speed release and I cut back in, like who teaches that? Coaches say, all right, just beat this guy. At the end of the day, it's about the perception of how you can beat this guy.
Interesting. And I have a lot of questions regarding that. How many skills coaches do you work with outside of the Colts coaching staff?
Who a skill?
Like, do you have a trainer for
DB,
you? Like, do you have a trainer for your DB work? Do you have a? I'm sure you got a workout dude. You got somebody you're working out with on a regular. You got a guy like that.
I just go to a regular trainer. At the end of the day, if I focus solely on just like
and you
breaking
look like
and
that,
doing
just
that,
doing it on your own.
Yeah.
Oh man.
My trainer.
We're doing it wrong.
At the end of the day, it should be about balance and you knowing your body. If you know your body, you can do whatever you want.
Well, I know my body, and it tells me no a lot.
Well, again, but how can you get your body better?
Well, that's a good question.
I worked on my hips this past year, and I feel like I'm going to be more explosive this year.
Open your hips.
Open your hip. Yeah.
Gotcha.
Hey, just gloss over, because I don't want you saying a negative about another player. That's not where I'm going with this. But I look, you're a safety. You're all pro special teams guy, but you're a safety. I look, you know, and this is Cowboy country. You know that Cowboys have been hunting for a safety forever. Yep. And for whatever reason, you know, Jerry Jones just refuses to pay the money that top safeties are getting. So the Cowboys have just gotten by with guys.
What is the defensive scheme? It all surrounds on what the defense needs, like what the defense wants. Say if you got some great linebackers, great D-line, you don't need a good safety because they coming after you. You don't have time to throw the ball deep.
Well, you've watched Ellis play.
Right? We need a good safety.
I don't know what to say about that.
We need a good safety, right? I mean, you know, but I look at a lot of teams that, you know, they need safeties. But they don't want to pay safeties.
But it's at the end of the day, how much money are you bringing in from the offense? They look at that too. Like, all right, sure. How much money are you spending on the offense? All right, now how much money can you spend on the defense? Do you have to pay your D lineman? Do you have to pay your linebackers? Do you have to pay your safeties first? It all depends. You got big name players. You got to pay them big name money, and so you can't afford big name safeties. You can't afford that. But you got to find a diamond in the rough. You got to find that guy that's willing to get better each and every year.
George Odum.
Well, that's it. Although,
go from there.
I bet, you know, where you signed a tender offer this year, right?
Yeah.
And so just one more year left in Indianapolis. Is it under contract anyway for now?
Well, under contract, yeah, for now. But at the end of the day, I like Indianapolis. Yeah, I feel like it's a second home to me right now. So,
but you have a third home apparently in Dallas. I mean, I'm just saying, you know, I'm not going to be your agent or anything, but they need a safety.
They need a safety, but they don't got one.
You know, they don't, honestly. But, you know, you've made your bones as a special teamer, all pro. That's something that never goes away. It's in the books. It'll be in the Hall of Fame forever. When you get that starting gig, which looks like you're getting it now, you go earn it. Get it. And are you going to be upset about giving that up? Do you want to?
It's about perception. Mm-hmm. So how do the league see me right now? Do they only see me as a special team player or they see me as starting safety?
Honestly, they see you as a special team player. That's honestly, where they saw you.
Yeah. In all actuality, they see me only as a special team player mm-hmm. right now. They have film. And every single game I played in, except probably one, I had winning grades. I had turnovers. I had outrageous stats. But at the end of the day, I'm killing people on special teams. So why change?
Do you like that? Would you ask to stay on
longevity, special teams? Longevity. If you could play 12 plays, six of them not in contact, what would you do for $2 million?
A good 15-year career. I think about the long snapper that the Cowboys had for 15, 16 years.
But look at this. You have that perception right there. But look at this. You can play 60 plays, not full speed on defense. You only make seven plays out of the whole time. You get $60 million for 4 years. What would you do? That's a lot. But the stakes are higher. If you get beat, hey, it's on you.
Well, we talk about you on Monday is what happens.
So at the end of the day, you can make mistakes a little bit on special teams. You can get away with it. But sometimes on defense, you cannot make them mistakes. So it's at the end of the day, it's about your focus and how you coordinate your life and how you want things to be seen.
I like to be a fair guy, George, when we're talking football. And, you know, a lot of times, you know, fans, and I'm guilty of this too, as I say this, we'll see a guy get beat for a touchdown. And, man, that guy sucks. He gets beat all the time. And then you start talking to coaches, and you realize that wasn't his responsibility.
Yeah, what
right?
coach was
I mean, because most fans don't know that.
Yeah.
How unfair is it for defensive backs playing in the NFL right now with all the rules geared toward the offense and fans not really understanding what your job was? We all think we know what you're supposed to be doing, but the reality is we don't. Like a lot of interceptions. You mentioned earlier, you know, your first interception came off of Dak Prescott. It was a tip ball from the tight end, but there's a lot of times, you know, a quarterback will throw it to a spot, receiver doesn't run the wrong route, and it looks like the quarterback just had a bad throw, right?
Well, that was a bad quarterback because you're not going to throw it to a spot. You're going to throw your man open. Your eyes see more than what you think. You see way more than what you think. And it's about working on say if I'm a quarterback, I'm working with my receiver every day because I know where he's going to be at.
Mm-hmm.
And so I have trust in him, so I'm going to throw him the ball right in that same spot, like you said, that same spot because I know he's going to be there. I'm not going to work with a guy one time out of the year, and I know he's not going to be there. We might ran five routes. Shoot, we only ran it five times, so I don't know if he's going to be there or not.
Yeah.
I'm going to look at him the whole time to make sure he get there. So it's that right there.
I don't expect you to name names, but if you want to, you're more than welcome. Are there certain quarterbacks in the league that you look at and when you're prepping the week before, go, I cannot wait to jump that route? Are there certain guys in the league that you feel pretty comfortable, if I get the opportunity, I can go get that one? Go get
it. I'm going to tell you a little secret about Green Bay quarterback. When he under center, he never hikes the ball until he brings both of his feet in. If you ever notice that.
The tail.
He gonna come down. But until he bring both of his feet in, like he gonna have him wide. Bring both of his feet in. On the second step, he hiked the ball. So that's it's tails that people do, right? Because it's repetition over and over. So you gotta see that.
You know, it's interesting. Datwin, former Cowboy linebacker, used to work on this station. We were at training camp one day.
Datwin played at
Texas A&M. No, I'm messing with you.
Yeah. But when we were at training camp, we were about 6-7 plays in, and he was like going left, like going. And I said, how'd you know? And he says, the guard puts his elbow on his knee pad for the direction the play is going in. Every time.
Oh, yeah. And O-lineman got tails too. Like all of them do. So the dude named George Lee. He sent, no, it's not even George Lee, but they send you what the O-linemen do. Like,
right.
They super big, so sometimes they can't touch the ground, but when they touch the ground, there's a run play. They lean in more forward, or they lean in more back, three O-linemen down, two O-linemen up. Like, it's a lot of tails, but at the end of the day, it's about performance. Like, it's about reaction time. How fast can you react, and how fast can you make the play?
He reacts pretty well. He got an all-pro trophy to prove it. That's George Odum, safety with the Indianapolis Colts right here on ESPN San Antonio. Man, we wish you the best of health, first of all, and have yourself a great season, man.
Appreciate you.
You've really got a lot going for
really
you.
Appreciate that.
Look forward to having you back.
Yes, sir.
George Odum right here on ESPN San Antonio.